Hey guys, Pat Hazard here, coming for another cold intro to the Talking Chop podcast. Mainly I'm just going here to explain why it's been gone for another 6 months. Well, kids, what can I honestly say? The main reason is because life is tough and sometimes you gotta just focus on other things that you can't easily put online. So I've been sort of getting my life together and the dust has settled, the clouds are clearing, and it looks to be a little bit brighter around here. So you should be getting to see a little bit more content, both the video and audio kind. So without further ado, this is actually a very exciting podcast that we're about to have with an amazing person, and I'm just gonna let myself introduce him. So Pat, whenever you're ready, take it away. All right, so hi everybody, welcome to another episode of Talking Shop. What is Talking Shop? It is the premier podcast of the Choking Hazard the Hazard Channel. With me today is a very special guest, someone who I admire greatly. His talent is fantastic. His wit is uncompromised by none. He has his own Blip channel. He has a physical / digital CD that he just
released. If I may interrupt for just a second. If it's uncompromised by none, does that mean it is compromised by some?
I believe it is not compromised by any.
Well, I think it's always compromised by everyone. That's what it really means. That's what we're talking about.
Well, I mean, if you want to be so humble as to say it, I mean, that's your...
It's uncompromised by a small tribe of Portuguese people living in the bottom of the ocean.
Oh, no kidding.
Yeah.
Do you, like, visit them on a regular basis?
You know, whenever I don't know, ever since the chief died, I've just had less and less reason to, you know what I mean? But every now and then, at least once a year.
Yeah, you send them, like, fruit baskets or whatever.
Well, they can't really eat fruit because they're fish, but...
Oh, okay.
No, I send them fish food.
Oh,
it's
okay.
A tribe of fish who think they're humans is the problem, you know?
Ah, well, that explains it then. If you haven't guessed it by now, my guess for...
The band Fish is what I mean, with a PH.
Oh, I enjoy that band.
Yeah.
I don't...
Well, they're not human, you know?
Yeah, right.
They live at the bottom of the ocean, hence the name, but I think they're raccoons or something. I don't know. It's,
well, I thought,
it's weird.
So then they guest starred in your album.
No, that was an offshoot of them. That was the band Foul.
Oh.
Spelled P-H-O-U-L. Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right. Wait, so Foul is F-O-W-L or F-O...
You're overthinking it.
Yeah,
overthinking
I am. I am.
Okay.
All right, if you haven't guessed it by now, my guest is Tony Goldmark.
I am neither fish nor fowl, and I am Tony Goldmark here with you tonight. Hello, today, yes.
Mm-hmm. Also sometimes known as some jerk with a camera, sometimes
That's
known
right.
as the cardiac arrest guy, and sometimes very slimly known as Kill Bosby.
You know, here's the thing. I'm not in the best shape. I'm a big guy. I very well might actually, I mean, hopefully decades down the line, but I very well might actually die of a cardiac arrest,
well,
and won't that be ironic?
It would be ironic, but it would be more ironic if you were still filming at that time.
Well, yeah, if I'm doing a cardiac arrest joke where I have to kill off a character, I don't, because that's, the joke of that is basically, you know, I've never been that great at creating characters, or at least not recurring characters.
Mm-hmm.
And so the running gag I have on my show is that every time I create a potentially recurring character, I just kill him off immediately.
Have you killed...
Like, within the introductory sketch, I kill off every recurring character I introduce, I kill off with a cardiac arrest.
True that, but you haven't killed off people like Spaz yet.
Well, no, but he's a different person.
Oh, that's true. That's
I'm talking about recurring characters I play.
So did
specifically.
Did you kill off the rewritability character?
Yeah, I killed off Dr. What was his name? Professor Expert was
Professor
his name.
Professor Expert, right.
Oh. I killed off Professor Expert with a cardiac arrest. I killed off the gangster Joik Mahoney with
yes,
a cardiac
you
arrest.
Did. You did.
I killed off myself as Scott Baio with a cardiac arrest. And I killed off my evil twin brother Cramdlog with two cardiac arrests in
yes,
a row.
Yes, you did. Yes, you did.
And then I blew him up with dry ice.
For Christ. Woo!
I remember way too much about shows I've done. That's enough. There's no bigger me nerd than me. That's...
Mm-hmm. Well, that's because you just can't let any of your clones just live.
No, of course not.
Yeah. Because then...
create too much Freaky Friday confusion.
I know, right?
They'd be spending all day trying to get my parents back together and stuff. I mean, it's like, half of my parents are dead. Stop trying. You can't talk to clones. They don't have that reason. I mean, they don't have
logic protocols.
You know, do not even get me started. I'm serious.
Okay.
Do not.
Whoa.
You're doing it. You're doing it, and that's the problem, is you're getting me started on... You've gotten me started on clones.
Well...
And now I can't, you know...
Well, if I be so...
You know how painful they are to birth? Just, I mean, you know, because they... Especially, I mean... Move on. Next topic. Next topic?
Okay.
Next topic.
So, abstinence. You approve... pro or against?
I abstain from abstinence.
You abstain
myself.
From abstinence. Okay.
Well, whenever I, but well, I am, I do abstain, but not voluntarily.
Ah, okay.
That's.
So religious reasons?
No, just women find me repulsive reasons.
Well, then I apologize.
Ah, don't.
Well, I would assume that the ladies would be landing near your feet because of the just infamy you have as some jerk with a camera.
One would hope so, wouldn't it?
I know,
wouldn't
right?
One? I mean, I don't know why they're not. Get on that, man.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. So, I've come here to ask you a couple of questions.
Where have you come? To your computer?
Via Skype, yes.
You flew all the way to Los Angeles by way of Hawaii, and then... Mm-hmm. Where do you live, by the way? New York?
I live in New Jersey.
New Jersey, okay. So you came all the way to New Jersey from New Jersey, but you went around the world to do so.
Yes,
first.
I took the whole hot air balloon route.
Oh, the hot air balloon route. That's, mm-hmm. That's nice. It's scenic.
You know, once you catch those jet streams, you really kind of get over all the din of like New York City and Chicago and all that.
Well, the lack of oxygen causes you to hallucinate. So I'm sure the three-headed purple dragon helped you get around the world.
No, surprisingly,
really?
It was less helpful than I thought.
Oh,
However, the two-footed...
He didn't sing to you about imagination for 6 minutes, did he?
No.
Okay, well, then you got lucky.
My parents, which was disturbing.
Oh, okay. Well, there, you know, they all do that. I mean, that's a given. It's expected.
I know. So, Goldmark After Dark.
Yes.
It's your first album that you've released in 10 years, you've stated.
My first solo album,
solo album. Okay.
I did release an album under the... 5 years ago, in the midway point there, I did release an album under the name Flying Like Wilma, which was a band I formed... I don't really want to talk about it, but it was basically... I decided I wanted to release this batch of songs as a band called Flying Like Wilma rather than under my name, Tony Goldmark, and I've since decided to abandon that practice, so here mm-hmm. I am.
Did you... Now, the Flying by Wilma, was that your source, like...
Flying Like Wilma.
Flying Like Wilma.
Yes,
was that
because...
first foray into comedy music album?
No, I've been doing comedy music since I started my very, very first album. This is going all the way back
mm-hmm.
to I was literally 12 years old when I recorded it.
Nice.
It came about through a beautiful bit of nepotism. My mother decided to have a nervous break, to have a midlife crisis, basically,
mm-hmm.
and start her own record label.
Oh, that's
called Don't
awesome.
Quit Your Day Job Records, and she's looked at me and said, "Well, you're a cute kid. Want to record an album?" And I was like, "Okay." And it came about in a very Stanley Spadowski and UHF kind of way, where I just recorded 10 horrible songs, and my mom knew a bunch of musicians, so we threw an album together, and it got a bit of notoriety as just, "Oh, look, the novelty of a 12-year-old singing these annoying kids songs." Which also had kind of a comedic bent. One of the songs got played on Dr. Demento a few times, so that was pretty cool. But yeah, I
How
didn't
did he
really
get to Dr. Demento.
Well, Dr. Demento takes applications from just about any. I mean, literally anyone mm-hmm. can send him music, and if he likes it, he plays it. And that's how it's been since like 1973 or so, right. Almost since he started. So he's very supportive of. I mean, honestly, he doesn't get the credit he deserves now for kind of starting. You know, I mean, obviously now you know you kids today with uh-huh. your YouTubes and your SoundClouds and things, you can just record a dumb little song in your bedroom and the world can hear it at a moment's notice. No, back in the 90s, back in the 80s, you couldn't do that. Literally the only way for independent artists to gain exposure to gain national exposure without a record label was Dr. Demento. And I'm not kidding about that at all. He would play tapes from just about anyone. He was the first DJ, obviously, to discover Weird Al Yankovic, which he gets a lot of credit for. Mm-hmm. What he doesn't get credit for is, like, he was the first DJ outside of a few local stations in Akron to ever play Devo. Like, that's...
You're kidding me.
I am not kidding at all. Dr. Demento was the first guy to give Devo national radio exposure.
And by that, also bringing exposure to Danny Elfman, I must believe.
Well, Danny Elfman was Oingo Boingo. Mark Mothersbaugh.
Oh, Oingo! I get those two mixed up, and that's retarded of me. That needs to be stop immediately. Considering I consider myself a freelance composer, that's ridiculous.
Well, I didn't want to say anything, but yeah.
Yeah. Well, thank you.
You can edit that part out if you like.
No, of course.
All right. So. Mm-hmm. But yeah, Dr. Demento, I was like 12 years old. My song was getting played on Dr. Demento. I got a couple of little TV gigs off just the sheer novelty of, oh, a 12-year-old's doing, a were child they, is doing children's records. Look at
it,
this.
Was it like sort of local to the California scene?
The one, most of it was local, yes. The one basic cable gig I got was on some sort of, I don't even remember what the show was called, but it was some sort of MSNBC show where, and this was 1997, I want to say, but it was like a tech show. It was like a show about computers, and one of the songs on the album was about computers. And so I got a gig singing that on this basic cable show with like this very primitive version of motion capture.
Oh, really?
Like, the character behind me. Like, the interviewer was interviewing me with, like, a motion capture suit. So I just had to stare at, like, a green dot on the wall, and they inserted it in post later. It was ridiculous, and I hope to God nobody finds the clip. I really do. Mentioning it now, people
know,
are going
right?
to look for it. And that's not fair. You should stop, because
people are probably
genuinely
also be searching
it's
for...
It's not even so bad, it's good. In the words of Ghost World, it's so bad, it goes past good and back to bad again. It really does. But anyway, so... Mm-hmm.
People are probably also going to be searching for your flying, like, Wilma.
Well, that's easy to find. That's on iTunes. That I'm not ashamed of. There's some good stuff on that album. But I'm not going to tell you the name of my children's album from the 90s. That you're going to have to search for.
Okay.
But the, what I'm building towards...
I think I did find a website that actually
listed you probably did. So anyway... Mm-hmm. Thank God it didn't go anywhere past that, because I could only imagine the complete entitled prick I would turn into if I'd be... I mean, just look at what's happening to fucking Justin Bieber now. And
true that.
There, but for the grace of God, go I, basically, mm-hmm. is what... I'm not saying I'm even as talented as him at the time, but it's just, thank God it never... Thank God I didn't become a meme. I would have been so... I would not have handled the fame well.
Feel that you would have come from humble roots.
And by the way, I'm not saying like, oh, I was so good, I should have been famous. No, my point is that literally anyone can become famous in this day and age. And
true, it was very true.
And that could have been me. Not because I was talented, but because it was so goddamn stupid and dumb. So,
and you were being famous for novelty.
Right, for a complete novelty, not because I had talent. And so thank God it faded into obscurity, is what I'm saying. So anyway, a few years later, But through like getting on Dr. Demento and being such a huge fan of Weird Al and a huge fan of comedy music in general, I couldn't get the Dr. Demento show in my area. So, but I started listening to whatever I could, and I just became a huge fan of that kind of music. And years later, you know, my mom and dad still knew a bunch of musicians, and I was able to pull some strings, get a few songs recorded, and by my 18th birthday, I had my second album released. I won't say the name of that one either, because I'm not terribly fond of it. But a few years after that, I released my third album, which is on iTunes, and that is called Rage Against the Mundane. And it was released in 2004, and that is what I'm talking about when I say my first solo album in 10 years.
Right. Okay.
Now, Rage Against the Mundane had... the big hit from that album was a track that I've actually mentioned on Some Jerk with a Camera called Sirius Black.
Yes,
and,
yes.
Sirius Black, I don't know, it was kind of, you know, I was friends, it's a whole long story I don't want to get into, but basically, at the time I did the song, I was really good friends with Luke Ski.
Right.
AKA the great Luke Ski. I'm friends with him again now, and there was a long period where I wasn't friends with him in between these two 10 years apart albums. That's the part I don't want to get into.
Right.
But my point is, at the time, and Sirius Black was pretty much my blatant attempt to do a Luke Ski-esque track.
Because
he wasn't really doing Harry Potter song. He wasn't reading the books. He'd seen a couple of the movies, but he didn't really care. So I was like, well, I like Harry Potter. Maybe I'll do that for this.
Mm-hmm.
And the song, and I don't know, If I'd had this idea any other time in my life, I would have instantly rejected it, because it just sounds so much like it shouldn't work. But the song was a parody of Sir Mix-a-Lot's Baby Got Back called Sirius Black, about the Prisoner of Azkaban.
I believe I have heard this. I don't know.
Yeah. It developed such a crazy life of its own that it didn't deserve. I mean, that is the closest thing I've ever done to something that has become a meme.
Or viral.
At least within... Yeah, that's the closest I've ever come to going viral was the song Sirius Black. And it was the...
When was that floating around? Circa what year was that?
That would have been 2004, around
okay,
the time the,
so that
would
have been
Alfonso Cuarón Prisoner of Azkaban movie was coming out. So.
Okay, and like right around the time that like Neil Cicierega was getting redeveloped again?
Right, that was, he kind of picked up the boat that I jumped off of.
Right,
you know, he jumped on the boat kind of just as I was jumping off, because I didn't know what I had.
Right.
You know, because at the time I had this weird integrity, like, I don't want to be the Harry Potter guy, I want to be the all around, you know,
comedy guy.
I don't want to be pigeonholed into this thing. And of course, years later, I'm doing this series just about the Disney park. So I'm obviously not worried about being pigeonholed anymore.
Right.
But my point is, the if I had really, like, I sometimes do think about, like, wow, the following year I could have done Potter Said Knock You Out, and then the year after that I could have done 99 Problems But a Snitch Ain't One, and I could have just gone on indefinitely.
You could have developed a whole album based off of Harry Potter based covers.
It's funny you should mention that, because I did do an EP shortly after the success of Sirius Black. Well, based on the success of Sirius Black, I was invited to perform in 2005 at a Book 6 release party in the Chicagoland area. It was like this big con-type event at a mall that was adjacent to a Barnes & Noble where they were releasing the book at midnight. And I did a few songs, but for the set, I was like, well, I don't want to just bring my album. I want something else. So I recorded on the quick, just at home in my bedroom, no studio, just a bunch of instrumental tracks, this like 8-song EP just with a bunch of random, you know, songs about the Harry Potter universe. And one of the songs, it turned out so well that I re-recorded it later. And it wound up on the Flying Like Wilma album. That's a blues song about Snape, which I still think holds up pretty well. I still like it a lot. So anyway,
So you do play instruments sometimes for your
I
albums?
I do not. No, I don't play any instruments. I've always gotten by solely on the musician friends that my parents know, because I'm lucky to have musically inclined parents who
And relatives that I recall as well.
My dad's a steel guitar player. He's played for a my favorite story about his steel guitar playing was that he played on. You know who Neil Hamburger is, right?
I do recall of that name. Yes.
Okay. Neil Hamburger is basically he's the alter ego of a comedian named Greg Turkington, and he's basically a comedian who makes fun of comedians. Is what he does. He basically does this crazy like he's deliberately mocking like comedy itself. Mm-hmm. And he's deconstructing it, and the joke flies over some people's heads, including my dad. And he said, and this is even funnier if you're a fan of Neil Hamburger. But I was talking to him about it, and I was trying to explain who Neil Hamburger was, and my dad said you could not have phrased this better, the perfect dad thing to say about Neil Hamburger, which was, look, I get the joke. The joke is that he's a shitty comedian. Well, excuse me for saying that the emperor has no clothes. It was, I wish I had been filming him.
Oh my gosh. That's
I love you, Dad, if you're listening.
Yeah.
Thank you for giving me a career. So,
anyway, yeah. All right.
So, where was I? I'm went off on this huge tangent. So.
Yeah, that's perfectly fine.
Yeah.
But yeah. So, I mean, from your, as you said, 10 years since your last solo album. I mean, has a lot of the process changed from when you started out to what you're doing now? Or is it still kind of vaguely similar?
It's more similar than it is different. The biggest difference now is that I'm handling a lot more of the producing responsibilities. I mean, how it's done really isn't changed at all. What's changed is who's doing it.
Right.
Because like in that first album when I was 12, you know, I was 12. The engineers would do stuff, and then I'd go, you know, fool around in the fucking lobby for a while, and then say, okay, we're ready for you to record vocals now, and then, you know, that, it was as simple as that. And now I'm much more involved in, like, okay, here's how I still don't get involved that much in the music, because, like I said, I don't play an instrument, I don't know much about music, I wouldn't know a G from a C sharp or anything like that, so...
So when you're vocalizing most of your things, would you say that you're improvising your melodies, or are you at
least... Sort of. I basically know what I want the melodies to sound like, but my dad is a really big help in that regard. He's great at, like, really fleshing it out and putting what I want on paper in a language that musicians will understand.
Good.
He's an invaluable resource, definitely, and he handles a lot of that stuff. But nowadays, on days when we're just recording vocals, half the time he won't even show up, because he knows, like, I know what I want, I know what I'm doing, you know, that I have a very specific idea of how, you know, and also how I want the song mixed, you know, that sort
right.
of thing. I mean, he's always there. He's there to help when I need it, definitely, but I'm much more involved in, you know, the... I like to say that when we're in the studio, like, he's the one thinking like a musician, and I'm the one thinking like a comedian. And sometimes we butt heads in precisely that regard, but he's, you know, great on the music side of things, so it's a good relationship. It really is.
It sounds like a healthy working relationship is what it is.
And by the way, I'm still using the same engineer that I've used since 2001.
That's fantastic.
A dude by the name of Garth Weber, who has his own studio in Berkeley. He set up in his basement. He's a fantastic musician. He's played with Miles Davis in the past.
Oh, wow.
He's a great guitar player. He's a fantastic engineer, and... I wouldn't want to work with anyone else at this point, frankly.
Did he perform on this album itself?
A little bit. We had a couple of really great he did guitar on one track, actually the shortest track on the album.
The Abstinence Anthem?
Yes, he performed guitar on that, and he did some background vocals here and there, but I think a couple of times, like, No. I'm thinking of something else. Sorry. Mm. But the he wanted. It wasn't what he. I think it's just that we had other guitar players in the studio. We called in because we wanted specific things done on specific songs that that. Oh, why Garth didn't play guitar? Come to think of it, but we got some really good guitar. We got Hank Manninger and playing guitar on some of it, and Gary Potterton playing on the rest.
Yes.
So it's and Paul Olguin on bass, Henry Salvi on keyboards, and Paul Ravelli on drums.
Which his drum solo in.
Everything else?
Yeah, everything else was fantastic.
That was a kind of a leap of faith there, to be honest. It was I just told him like go crazy and he was and it was a bit of a it was hard to explain. I knew exactly what I wanted and eventually we got it. Like what I wanted is what we eventually got in the song, but it took a while to explain it to everyone and but I'm very proud of how it turned out. So
you should be. It's like I said. It's something that I jam to on a regular basis because usually when I get certain albums or certain music, I end up listening to them to a very large amount of time just because it. I just feel comfortable with it, and I've come to like listen to a lot of your album on the rides home and back and forth, and it is. Fantastically produced. It sounds great. And I mean, some of these songs, like, you know, I get a nice chuckle, and then some of them I have like huge laughs where I'm like, I have to pull over. This is gonna I think Officer Down was one that I had to pull over.
Oh, good old Officer Down.
That song I showed to my girlfriend, and she was like, that is horrible. And I said, I know. It's fantastic, isn't it?
It's so wrong, it's right.
I know.
I mean, it's just I'm thankful that I haven't gotten, like, I'm not saying, oh, I'm so edgy, blah, 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 but I'm glad that people haven't taken that much offense to it. People in general get that it's just a joke and that their angered efforts are probably best spent on things worth getting angry about. But,
right.
Man, that song! the inspiration of that song just kind of came like a bolt of lightning, and I'm glad
you just
and
went
I put
with
it,
it
off, and I put off recording it for a while because I was convinced it wouldn't work. Like
really?
it was so perfect in my. Because here's the thing: the music has to sound amazing for that joke to really work. It
True.
Has to sound like a real. Of that, I don't want to spoil the joke, really, but it has to sound like a real version of that type of song.
Right.
And I was convinced, like, my vocals wouldn't be good enough or something.
No, it was
or that
fantastic.
Everything gelled. I'm very proud of how it turned out. It was amazing, but I was worried it would be too much work, and I kept putting it off and putting it off, and finally in the last recording session of this album, I was like, you know what? Fuck it. It's funny. We're doing it. Mm-hmm. And, it's my personal favorite song on the album. It really is.
Well, this one of mine too. And I actually, to go off of what you said, like how long did it take you to produce this album?
Off and on, took about, well, from when we started recording it to, release 4 years. Now here's the thing. This is off and on. Like, we recorded it, we recorded a few songs, like, we recorded it in thirds. The first third of the album we recorded in summer of 2010.
Okay.
August of 2010, we recorded it for about 2 weeks. Another 2 weeks in August of 2011. And then 2012, due to various things in my life, we didn't get into the studio. But then we recorded the last 30 in June of 2013. And I didn't put it out until April of 2014 because I wanted to wait till the second season of Some Jerk was over.
That makes sense. And... So you tend to juggle sort of the audio projects with the video projects? Is that kind of...
Sometimes. I mean, like right now, I just released an album, so I'm not even going to be thinking about doing another,
right.
You know, album project for a while. So I'm going to concentrate just... Well, although I am... Well, I don't want to talk about it, but I am kind of doing something similar to that for an upcoming project I can't talk about. But But no, right now I'm basically just focusing on getting the third season of Some Jerk up and running, and that in and of itself will probably take a while. But
how long does it take you to film Some Jerk with a camera? Actually,
it depends like crazy. It because I keep the thing is, and this is especially true for well, I usually only film one day at a time,
right?
Because I just go there, I prepare a shot list, I just get all the shots I think I need, and that's it for a while. But, like, for the ABC retrospective, I kept thinking up new shit. Literally, there's not a single one of those episodes that I did not rewrite and rewrite and rewrite and add and slash things and just keep, and just continuously, you know... I kept thinking of new angles to come at, because that's the thing I notice when I'm editing, is I keep... editing is a surprisingly fertile source of material.
It very much is.
Because you keep... because when you're forced to watch this clip over and over again, you're forced to, you know, you're forced to think about it in new ways, and you're forced to come to conclusions of, well, wait a minute... did they just raise the dead there? Did the witches just, you know,
right.
that whole bit was a complete 11th hour addition to the Sabrina episode. Like, and I didn't know how I would do it. I had to call Morgan and go to her house to shoot that. And it was literally like, just a couple weeks before I released the episode. And I mean, it was done. I was finished. I was about to put a fork in it.
Right.
And I just could not get the idea out of my head. Well, you know, that I wasn't paying enough attention to the fact that they were... For those who don't know, in the Sabrina Disney World episode, they go to Animal Kingdom and they visit the dino exhibit, and there's a scene where the witches find a bone and bring its owner, which is a caveman, back from the dead. Life. So these witches can raise the dead. All they need is your femur, and doesn't that solve every conceivable problem in their universe?
You would think eventually we'd find Jimmy Hoffa.
You'd find Jimmy Hoffa. You don't need to eat. You don't need to go to school. You don't need to have a job. If you starve to death, they'll just preserve your femur and bring you back to life.
Exactly.
It's like, and it's this has to be addressed. I came up with this whole sketch where Sabrina's aunt just kept killing Sabrina over and over again,
and she rises her them, like.
Yeah, and they kept bringing her back 100 years later, and it turned into this. I don't want to spoil the sketch, but it's one of the funniest scenes I think I've ever done, and I'm not in it, which is part of what makes it funny. It's just Morgan talking to herself over and over again, and she does a great job.
Did she improvise?
Hi, Morgan,
a lot of
if
those
you're
lines?
Listening.
Did she? Did she?
No. There's very little improv on Some Jerk with a Camera. Improv is a thing that I tolerate, but and I'm all for plussing scripts through improv and using it as a garnish. But
right.
But you can't rely on it because it's an unstable beast. You don't know when inspiration's going to strike and when it's going to be, you know,
bombing.
You got to go in with a good script right away. You cannot depend on, oh, once we're there, we'll just make up everything and it'll be good. No, that's how someone I won't name operates. But
yeah, because I've noticed that there are some people who like tend to work with a little bit of improv, but they use the script as more of a guideline to anything else because they have to have a yes and sort of style to doing it.
And that's valid too if you're working with the right people. If you're working with people really trained in improv, like Judd Apatow, obviously,
right.
You know he doesn't pick people for his movies cavalierly. He picks people he knows will deliver. Same with Christopher Guest and all those, you know, improv heavy directors.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a great improv guy, and I'm not great at shouting. You know, I'm an okay improv guy. I think I'm a better writer. I will come up with a funnier joke if you give me a minute to think about it.
Okay.
You know, and you're not pressuring me to say the perfect joke in the moment.
Right.
You know, and that's just me. But yeah, I would never just go to the park and say, okay, I'm gonna make up a bunch of stuff today and that'll be the episode. No,
right.
that would not make a good
no,
episode.
No, that would, and especially with such a
Although,
oops. Okay.
I'm sorry. I have done episodes like that, but they're bonus episodes. Like Those are the Attack of the LA Reviewers shows I used to do where, where basically me and a bunch of friends would just go to Disneyland or someplace and we'd just riff for a while. And I'd string together the funniest parts of that. And those episodes are okay, but there's a reason they're just bonus episodes and not part of the official Some Jerk canon, as it were.
Exactly. And, you know, sort of like the Would You Rathers.
Right. That's another where which was stolen from Scott Aukerman at the Comedy Bang Bang podcast.
Right. But and you know. I've listened to them once in a while. That's fabulous, great stuff that I get.
Well, they used mine once. The very one I used. Yeah, the very one that I one of the ones that I used in the bonus video. Comedy Bang Bang, I submitted to them and they actually used in an episode a few years ago with Margaret Cho and David Wayne and James Adomian. And that one was Would You Rather Something Something or Direct an All Kangaroo Shot for Shot Remake of E.T.
Right.
Which I still want to see. I still want to see someone do that. The All Kangaroo. Yeah.
But could you sub out the kangaroos with wallabies?
I would definitely subjugate against the wallabies. Yes, because they are impure.
They're impure. Why? They're just impure. Because they're a little bit smaller?
No, because they're not cartoons. I grew up with Rocco's Modern Life, and I expect a certain cartoonishness out of my wallabies.
True. But don't you? Don't.
Are you not one of? Are you not a member of the master race?
Unfortunately, I'm not, sir.
All wallaby. You know, they told me when I agreed to do this podcast,
right?
Your producers up in their Hollywood towers. They told me that you understood.
I don't.
Now, were they just trying to silence me? Were they just trying to?
Listen,
telling me what I wanted to hear so I would do this stupid podcast?
Listen, I don't think he's buying it anymore. Is the check still being sent?
Hey! Don't ignore me!
Hi, Paul. So, next question.
Yes.
So, let's talk about some of the songs on the album.
No! Okay, go ahead.
God, that was a horrible segue. I apologize.
The horrible segue is the one I tried to build the other day. It doesn't go worth a darn.
All right. You didn't get the...
That one failed. I'll go jump out the window. Whee!
You gonna follow Calgary on that one?
Oh, yeah. He's waiting at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
That was over a year ago. He's dead.
The soft. All
his newer episodes since then, it's just a hologram.
It's just a hologram?
Just a hologram.
I thought it was more of animatronics. I thought they got some Disney engineers up in that stuff, you know.
Disney, I'm not on good terms with them anymore.
All right. You've moved over to the other
team.
Well,
and we'll see that in season 3.
Right. All right. So, let's talk a little bit about some of the songs on your album.
No. Yes.
No. Okay. Well, I mean, from going through some of the things, I've noticed a kind of theme with them.
A theme?
A theme in which the protagonist of some of these songs' stories tends to not all be there. But
then, I know what you're talking about. I'm sorry, go on.
No. Continue, because I would like to hear your take on how you sort of developed some of the ideas for these songs. Mainly, Everyone Else's Fault, The Road,
right. Yeah.
And,
There's some, like, The Guy on TV Is Not Happy and Take
yes.
Back America. There's songs on the album where the protagonist singing them,
SKJ.
It's just kind of one of, well, SKJ is a different animal altogether. That's more of a deliberate attack song.
Yeah,
but,
I want to. Can I? Ask?
Well, I'll tell the story about that, but let me answer the question
okay,
in order.
Apologize.
So, but yeah, that, one of my favorite just kind of subgenres of songs in general, or at least of comedy songs, is protagonists who are too buried alive in their own self-serving bullshit to know what monsters they are.
Mm.
You know, to re- I because nobody thinks they're the bad guy. You know, everyone's got, you know, everyone's got their own rationalizations for doing what they're doing. Like, you know, I want to make the world a better place today. What am I going to do to make the world a better place? I know I'll kill all the Jews. Or I know I'll say that God hates gay people. I'll do, you know.
Right.
Everyone thinks, everyone is the hero of their own story. So, I find that a lot more interesting than flat out saying you are wrong for doing what you're doing, you know, or for just being kind of sarcastic about it. Although I do a lot of that on the album too, but which I'll get to in SKJ. But the I just love the idea. That's just interesting to me, is just to go inside the head of a deeply fractured psyche. Some of my favorite songs are like that, like Psycho Killer by Talking Heads, or right. I'm trying to think of another good one. I know there's other good. I can't think of them at the moment, but
probably something from System of a Down maybe gets.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, definitely something from System of a Down. Definitely.
MSI.
A couple of Johnny Cash songs here and there. You know, just songs about killing people from the murderer's point of view. You know,
right?
Like, and that to me is interesting. It's like it's. I guess I just like to do it, because there's so many different layers you can go to with that.
True.
Like how the fuck do child molesters sleep at night? You know, or Burn, another great example of that song.
Right.
Just these
cartoon raccoons.
And to make it cartoon raccoons just takes the premise of several steps further.
I know.
So,
That kind of the three songs that sort of surround Burn is fantastic.
Thanks.
The sound design that's made for that to sort of create this kind of world that you made, it kind of feels like an extended universe to some jerk in some ways.
It is kind of. It's kind of an offshoot of that in a way.
Yeah. Because I knew you were toying with the raccoon ideas when you did something with Spaz's... call it what you like.
Yeah, I did Burn actually before that.
Oh, okay.
And I even released it on the FUMP before I did that. But so that was basically the cartoon raccoon, and that was Charlie's idea, by the way.
All right.
Because I think Zach had or someone had.
It was Zach.
Yeah, but Zach had screwed up his audio, or I don't know exactly what happened there, but the
jeez.
But he basically asked me to cover. And by the way, that whole idea goes all the way back to when I was in college. I did this short. Well, it wasn't really a short film I did, but I was taking this sketch comedy class. I went to Columbia College in Chicago,
okay.
And they have a whole TV. It's a media arts college that has a whole TV department,
right?
And they try to. And one thing they try to teach students is how to create. You know, TV in a studio, you know, how to make, you know, live TV doesn't really exist, but there are still, you know, sitcoms with multi-camera setups and
right.
They try to teach students, you know, how to, how to direct live TV. And the way they do that is they have a sketch show where the students learn by doing, and they wrote and every week a new sketch is recorded, and they also have a class for writing sketches.
Is that
broadcasted? Which feeds into that. It's broadcasted around the college campus on
excellent
on a short circuit feed. Yeah, it is good. I wish of course when I took the class, you know, I was such a, you know, that was when I was in college. I had all the Mr. Show DVDs and I was watching
right.
Around the clock. So I wanted our show to be as good as that.
Oh, boy.
You know, I wanted a bunch of knucklehead students, you know, to do a show that was as good as, you know, Kids in the Hall or the Ben
right.
Stiller Show or something. You know, I was serious. Like, why can't we be as good as Python? Huh? Why? because my classmates didn't give a shit. They were taking
right.
it for the grade. You idiot, me 7 years ago. So anyway, so basically, here's how incompetent the people were. One time, this one time they recorded a sketch. called Rehab with the Stars. It was a parody of Dancing with the Stars, but all the celebrities were these infamous drug addicts, like, you know, Mike Tyson and Andy Dick and stuff like that.
Right.
And it was putting them in rehab with fellow, you know, just ordinary people who needed to go through rehab. Easy sketch.
Easy sketch.
Nice idea. Yeah,
larger than life ideas. Larger
so
than
they
life
shot
personalities.
The thing. Right. Yeah. So they shot the thing. A simple idea. And the problem was every student in the director's class every week had a different task. So no one was a director all the way through. They rotated, you know, who would do different things. And the night they shot Rehab with the Stars, the student in charge of recording audio forgot to press a button.
Oh, no.
So when the editors in the editing class got the rough tapes, no audio at all.
Just zero.
Zero. Absolutely mute. The video was all there, but and there was even one shot where a boom mic was in shot, picking up all that wonderful audio that they didn't get. One of the main producers of this, an instructor by the name of Ed Ferrara, who was a really good friend with me in college, he knew at that time that I was doing these weird, like, little, you know, he knew I had a weird sensibility. He knew I was doing my own editing. I didn't have my own web series yet, but I had that weird sensibility. He just basically gave me the tapes and said, save us, you know, make this something. We don't care what it is. Just do your own weird thing to it.
Here's a microphone.
Yes.
Here's
exactly.
a room.
And I
Have
just
fun.
And I just made it the most bizarre fucking. I just let my id come out and just weird idea I had. Like, okay, the host, obviously Rehab with the Stars was hosted by Joe Rogan.
Oh gosh, right.
Or a student playing Joe Rogan. Mm-hmm. So I decided that instead of it being Joe Rogan, it would be 60 chipmunks in a man suit. And every
so
time
you did
he appeared
that, so
on
you,
screen, it was just a bunch of random chipmunk boys going, just ran. And everything every character said was a non-sequitur. And at the end, it was revealed that it was all a government conspiracy. And the very last shot of the sketch was just a title card that says, none of this happened. It was, and when I played that thing it wasn't even done when I was asked to show what I had so far to the class. When I showed what I had so far to the writing class, just to say, okay, here's how I'm proposing we save this thing. Never in my entire life, not even with my closest friends, have I ever shown anything I did to anyone that killed so hard. It was the hardest I've ever gotten any laughs for anything. So, and that kind of inspired me to get even more bizarre with stuff.
And would you say that also influenced some jerk with a camera in some way or another?
Well, it definitely encouraged some of the more bizarre episodes of Some Jerk with a Camera. But anyway, that's where 60 Chipmunks in a Man Suit came from, which I do my sort of little version of in the raccoon sketch on the album. And,
yeah.
And it inspired the... and I showed that... And by the way, you can still see that on YouTube, what I did. It's on my YouTube account, Tony Goldmark, and it's called Look at the Game Show. All caps.
Oh, really?
I titled it Look at... So just search Tony Goldmark, Look at the Game Show, and you'll see the bizarre sketch that on YouTube.
I actually, doing research for this particular interview, I discovered your YouTube channel. And actually, you're added... one of your videos is actually on my favorites now.
Cool.
It's the Scrooge McDuck song.
Oh, that. Yeah, well, that's on the Flying Like Wilma album.
That's
the one from 2009, which is available. And by the way, Rage Against the Mundane, Flying Like Wilma, Learning to Read. The Flying Like Wilma album, the band is called Flying Like Wilma, and the album's called Learning to Read Made Me Cool.
Mm.
So, which also contains a song you may have heard in my Step by Step episode. Anyway, it's so Rage Against the Mundane, Learning to Read Made Me Cool, and Goldmark After Dark are all on iTunes.
You can get them all right there.
Yep.
All right. Just search Tony Goldmark. You'll find
him. Tony Goldmark or Flying Like Wilma.
Right.
And you'll find the middle. So anyway, now, not all the stuff on the older ones are good. I do think that every album I do is leaps and bounds better than the one before, and there's a couple good songs on Rage Against the Mundane. There's more than a few good songs on Flying Like Wilma, and I think every song on Goldmark After Dark is good. Now we'll see how I feel 5 years from now, but
right.
Yeah. So anyway, so we were going to talk about SKJ next.
Yes, because that was an interesting song, because I have some theories as to who you're specifically attacking, but I don't want to, like,
Well, I've given it away elsewhere on the internet, so we may as well give it away here. Who do you think it was?
It's Nancy Grace, isn't it?
No, it's not, actually.
Oh, okay.
It's, but you're not far off. Are you familiar with a woman by the name of Victoria Jackson?
Is she some Fox affiliate? Because
she's been on Fox News quite a bit, but she doesn't have her own show, at least not yet.
Okay, all right.
But she is a popular Fox News pundit. Here's who Victoria Jackson is.
Okay.
She is an actress and former comedian who, in the 80s, she had a bit where she, you know, played ukulele and stuff. And her main thing was that, you know, her character on stage was basically a huge ditz. And that's where the comedy came from, is just her being a huge ditz. Now, here's the thing. She wasn't acting. She really kind of is that stupid. I mean, here's the thing. She got a lot of appearances on Johnny Carson's Tonight Show, which gained her a lot of notoriety. She, although, if you know how Johnny Carson felt about women in general, you kind of...
Right.
You know, that connects a few dots. But anyway, of why he'd have someone like her on the show.
Right, right, right.
But, and through the Carson appearances, she managed to become a cast member of Saturday Night Live from 1986 to 1992. For 6 years, opposite people like John Lovitz and Kevin Nealon and Dennis Miller, she would play, you know, one of her big, she did a Roseanne impression that was all right. She did, she mostly was the token girl in sketches. She played like, Donna Rice, I remember, she did in a couple of things. And, Well, she wasn't even the funny woman on the show at the time. Jan Hooks was the funny woman on SNL at that era. She was the one who was playing Tammy Faye Baker and getting all the laughs. And Victoria Jackson was just kind of there to, you know, fill in the crowd scene. So anyway.
It's all coming back to me.
Yeah. Then her most notorious claim to fame came in the year of 1989 when she got cast as the... Again, as the token girl, as the love interest, in a little movie by the name of UHF.
Oh, right.
Starring one of my personal heroes, Weird Al Yankovic. And apparently the two of them became pretty good friends afterwards, to the point where Victoria Jackson helped the song Smells Like Nirvana happen. Because it's a famous story. You know, Al was trying to get a hold of Kurt Cobain to ask permission to do the parody. You know, they were the biggest band in the world. They weren't hearing back from them. The managers, agents, you know, lawyers, answering machines weren't getting back to them. And finally, Jay had to say, you know what? I can't. His manager, Jay Levy, had to say, excuse me. Let me just take a sip of water.
Yeah, dude, go ahead and take a sip of water. Man, you've been talking for like.
That's all right. I do that. So anyway.
Yeah.
So his manager finally said, look, Al, if you want to get word out of Nirvana, you're going to have to call them yourselves. You're going to have to use your celebrity to get in touch with Nirvana. And Nirvana happened to be performing on Saturday Night Live that week. And Victoria Jackson was still a cast member of Saturday Night Live. And famously, Al called her up at, you know, 30 Rockefeller Center in New York and said, hey, can you put the band on the phone? And Victoria Jackson, you can just imagine, you know, Victoria Jackson, this conservative Bible-thumping, you know, tiny blonde girl just entering Kurt Cobain's dressing room and saying, the Weird Al wants to talk to you. It's like,
I would imagine Kurt Cobain would have been gung-ho.
Oh, well, once they got him on the phone, absolutely. Kurt Cobain loved the idea. He immediately, you know, well, just sort of as an afterthought, he asked Al, is it going to be about food? And Al said, no, actually, it's going to be about how no one can understand your lyrics. And Kurt said, oh, great. And
that's fantastic.
Kurt Cobain, it just came out, there was an interview with Courtney Love in, I think, Rolling Stone or something, where she revealed that, you know, Kurt Cobain, as you'd expect, had a massive record collection, but as you might not expect, had a lot of novelty records. And
yeah,
he was a huge Dr. Demento fan at the time, and he kind of considered like what I was saying earlier about it being the original, you know, form of indie expression. It's like I think he recognized and appreciated that. And which makes me even, you know, more pissed off that he blew his brains out, because we could have used comedy music could have used a supporter as famous as him.
As someone as big as him. Yeah.
Exactly, exactly. So anyway. So Victoria Jackson, famous among Al fans for being in UHF and for making Smells Like Nirvana happen. And the years went on, you know, she did a very short-lived show on Comedy Central with Julie Brown called Strip Mall. Mm. She was in the movie Casual Sex with a Question Mark with Leah Thompson. Casual Sex with Leah Thompson and Andrew Dice Clay. And then you didn't really hear that much from her, like she, you know, blah, 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 blah. Then the year 2008 happened. And she joined the Tea Party! The lovely Tea Party. And since the Tea Party is desperate for any celebrity they can get, they embraced her wholeheartedly and made her a spokeswoman for their cause of exposing Obama as basically a communist Nazi Muslim.
Right.
And she has been beating the drum for that ridiculousness ever since. And here's the other thing. In 2008, when the news became all about, you know, Tina Fey's Sarah Palin impression on SNL.
Right.
And it was very, you know, Fox News wanted a former Saturday Night Live cast member to offer their opinion, preferably a female one.
Right.
To offer their opinion, because all females are the same, as we know, and, you know, to offer her opinion on Tina Fey's Sarah Palin impression, and who better than Victoria Jackson to give the Fox News.
Because, you know, she's got the in.
Oh, of course, yeah. Well, Fox News embraces her wholeheartedly because, you know, she's one of them. She's a fucking idiot. So it's, and she used to be vaguely famous, so, you know, they
right.
can... They can trust her opinion. And it's... But you listen to her babble for less than a minute, and it's painfully evident she's a complete fucking moron. You know, she's the dumbest person, and they gave her a microphone, and, you know, she's just saying, like, Obama is a communist because he's Satan! And he's Satan because he's a communist! Not her exact words, but may as well be, you know?
Right.
So anyway, so here's what I'm building up to. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
In 2009, there was a Weird Al fan convention. There used to be a few, like back in the late 90s, there were like Alcon 98, Alcon 2000, and Alcon 3 in 2002. Those were all in the Chicagoland area.
Okay.
Then Amanda Cohen, who was, there were basic Weird Al fan conventions. I was lucky enough to perform at all three because, like I said, I was making music since I was 12.
Right.
And it was getting played on Dr. Demento, so I was part of that original group. And, but then for years, the Amanda Cohen, the woman who was putting him on, couldn't afford to put him on anymore, so they just never happened for a while. And then 7 years later, in 2009, another woman by the name of Vicky DeVries, who was actually my very first Some Jerk with a camera person.
Oh,
decided she would pick up the baton, and she put on a convention called Alfest 2009.
Held in California?
That was held in California, and it was held in Costa Mesa, in particular. And I was lucky enough to perform there. And because it was 2009, 20 years after UHF, they held a UHF 20th anniversary panel.
Oh,
and because
that's
it was
Ixer.
Southern California, they were actually able to convince a lot of the actors who'd been in it to actually come out. Unfortunately, they couldn't get Al, because he was on vacation with his family in Hawaii at the time. But
right.
they were able to get David Bowie, the guy who played Bob, Jay Levy, who directed the film, they got Gede Watanabe, who played Cooney, and of course, who was also Long Duck Dong in 16 Candles.
Right.
And guess who the fourth panelist was?
Oh, no.
Miss Victoria. And this was 2009. This was a year. This was right after Obama got elected. And
right.
She was notorious by this point for being this, you know, right-wing crazy spark plug. Let me take another sip. And she was, and this community that I was a part of, you know, the Weird Al fan community, was going to watch her. I was sitting in the front row. There was no way I was missing
right.
this shit. And not the first thing out of her mouth, but actually, no, this was about midway through the panel, but
mm-hmm.
she was like, it was like watching a very stupid 9-year-old. It was like the... It was just the she I don't think she completed a single sentence. She would always start a sentence and then trail off and then land somewhere completely different.
Oh no!
It was just she did not get political. Thankfully.
Thankfully.
But, well,
did she overshadow a lot of the guests, or was she?
Well,
just...
she was just kind of the most memorable part of it. Like she was a complete ditz, but everything it was a great entertainment. Because here's the thing. The rest of the panel was just, you know, these three 50-year-old dudes all being asked specific questions about specific scenes. And they
right.
think about it for a minute and then just say, you know, it's all a blur. So,
right.
So, you know.
Kids, it's like 20 years ago.
Yeah,
I can't remember
it.
It's
not the most interesting panel. So even to have
right.
that kind of craziness was almost kind of, although I must say David Bowie did really well.
Mm-hmm.
He had a lot of good stories to tell. He was
good.
Not, he was no slouch. It was mostly Getty and Jay who just really didn't remember anything.
Right.
So,
you want to take another swig?
You know what? You talk about something for a bit and I'm just going to go get another bottle from the fridge.
Yeah, of all course.
Right? I'll be right back.
I can pause the recording. It's fine with that as well. But, so, folks, I have to tell you, unfortunately, Tony Goldmark had another cardiac arrest while we were recording this podcast. He is currently being revived by 72, I repeat, 72.
So then it turned out the Nazis were aliens, and boy, was egg on my face.
I know.
So anyway, all right. Here's the other thing. I think I told you this about Victoria Jackson, but I didn't really emphasize it enough. She is also uber Christian. Like she. Comes...
Well, you were conveying it a little bit by saying she was Bible thumping.
Yeah. She was Bible thumping. She's complete uber Christian. She's
which would make me really surprised that she would come out to an owl fest.
Well, here's the thing about that. Well, first of all, like she says the most, she says some of the most vile,
mm-hmm.
not political stuff, but just kind of vile as a human being stuff with the utmost cavalierness, you know, again, like with that kind of, you know, ditzy speak. So it sounds cute. And everyone, like she says, you know, my daughter's in the back of the room and her father, who I was married to for years, who's Satan. He was... Wait, did you just call the father of
father
your daughter
of your
who's in the room...
Satan? Right.
Yeah, I was married to Satan. He was horrible. Okay, look. I have no doubt you had good reason to divorce him. I believe you when you say that.
Right.
Satan? You're...
Don't... I mean, come on.
I mean, honestly... It's not nearly as offensive to me as it should be to you. You
right.
are religious. You do believe in this shit. Anyway. So, the fucking, but here was the kicker. Here was the
mm-hmm.
kicker. At one point, about midway through the panel, she described the first time she met Al. The
oh,
first time she
no.
met Weird Al. And, just... This is pretty much verbatim what she said.
Mm-hmm.
I went up to him
And I asked, are you a Christian? And he said, how did you know? And I said, because your eyes are loving.
You know, they signed autographs shortly after the show in the back of the room. I didn't really care to get, you know, I had a UHF poster I wanted signed by,
right.
You know, people. I wasn't really interested in getting her autograph, but it took me every nerve in my body not to say, I must be a Jew because my eyes are hating. Which, of course, led to the lyric. So basically, well, it led
this
to the
all
lyric
goes
in the
back.
Song.
Yeah. Yeah.
And here's the thing. Like, I wasn't even going to say a word to Victoria Jackson, but the person standing in line ahead of me to get autographs,
right,
went, you know, just, you know, pivoted back and gave me his camera and said, would you take a picture of me and Victoria Jackson? And me being a nice guy, I said, yeah, sure.
Yeah, of course.
I took the picture, and as I was taking the picture, she looked at me and said, I like your hair.
Mm-hmm.
Which, how can you entirely hate someone who likes you? You know,
yeah.
I mean, it's just makes it even more confusing. Also led to a lyric in the song. But anyway, so I realized I need to write a song about this. I need to write a song about just the weirdness of watching. Because later that night, they had a Shadowcast screening of UHF, which I was part of.
Right.
I played Kevin McCarthy's character, R.J. Fletcher.
Nice.
The bat, yeah, that was a lot of fun. But the, But it's just weird watching that movie, especially that final scene that parodies Gone with the Wind, where Weird Al and Victoria Jackson kissed.
Right.
And I just realized, you know, it looks like Satan kissing Jesus. It's the, and, which, SKJ, that led to the title of the song, so.
Which is the, and, wow.
Yeah, and I gave it kind of, and I decided, well, since this is an angry song about a very specific thing that happened to me, who's better at writing really specific angry songs about things that happen to them than Ben Folds?
Exactly.
So I gave the song a huge Ben Folds, like
old
school Ben Folds vibe.
Thank you for confirming that for me.
Yep.
Because I kept listening to it, and I'm like, God, it sounds like
a
Ben Folds song.
Yeah, I listened to the angrier tracks on Whatever and Ever Amen a lot to
right.
prepare for that one.
It sounded a little bit like a thousand eight or something, little angry dwarf.
No, yeah, one angry dwarf and 200 silent.
Yeah, faces.
200 solemn faces. Yeah,
yes, 200 solemn faces.
Yeah, that was a big inspiration for that. But I fucked something up major in that song, and that is, you know, the big huge bass sound that they used to
yes.
do in those songs. I thought that was a guitar. I did not realize that was a bass. So when we came and we'd record the bassist days before we were going to record
right.
the guitar, and I said, "Okay, just do that sound." And the engineer said, "That's a bass.
That is an electric
and
bass."
It's, oh shit! We didn't,
when Ben
to improvise, we had my dad record steel guitar in that part anyway. Instead,
it works.
It kind of works. It's all right.
It makes it your own.
You know what?
It...
That's how I'm rationalizing it. It made
right.
it my own. Damn it. So yeah. That. But that's the story behind SKJ.
SKJ.
And I did. And also on my YouTube page, I made a photo montage video of that song with pictures of Victoria Jackson and stuff. Because,
oh.
and here's what made me do that.
Mm-hmm.
Years later, after I'd already finished the song, she made a comment about the gay kiss, I think the first gay kiss on Glee,
oh,
saying
right.
that it was revolting and it was an insult to our American ideals. And I just had to say, I just had to post that song and say, you know, you're right. Some kisses are revolting.
Mm-hmm. And then
there you
that's
go.
What a roundabout way of developing that story, sir. That
well,
is fantastic.
Thank you. I try to be the most roundaboutest storyteller in all of internet land.
I mean, yeah, and it really sort of leads me to start asking about now going off of into sort of Some Jerk with a Camera land.
Mm-hmm.
When
we've been talking for an hour and we've barely mentioned Some Jerk with a Camera. That's
because, I mean, you're just, like,
well,
monumentous in the... And I'm not saying
are you,
that...
Is that a Don King word? Are you just making up the... He's
I'm
monumentous! It's unbelievable! It's
not one of those things where I'm, like, kissing your ass. I'm actually legitimately... fucking hate that word. But, I mean, you know, you're very talented, and that's why you know,
oh, thanks.
Scraping just the surface and then getting into the deeper parts about it makes it, you know, it just makes it so much more interesting to hear what people's take on things and how they've developed their stories and stuff like that. That's why I created this podcast, was specifically, was specifically to sort of like, get to see everyone's sort of take on what they do.
Yeah.
So, going on to, like, some jerk with a camera territory, if you have to go, please tell me. I mean, I don't want to keep you from
anything.
No,
I got all night.
Okay, but, yeah, okay, so let's go into the
My computer, I'm recording my half of the conversation on my computer.
Right.
And my disk space only remains about 97 hours and 55 minutes, so before then we have to wrap this up, but...
Okay, well, you know, by that point, you know...
97 most... hours, 54 minutes.
Yeah,
sorry.
My computer will be dead as well, because okay. I think mine will remain very short.
All right.
But, let's talk about Some Jerk with a Camera, because...
Let's do that.
Because you kind of, you kind of touched upon it when you were working in Chicagoland with, your classes. I mean, what was the first inkling that you were like, I want to review Disney World, or Disneyland, Disneyland?
I don't know the first inkling. I think I went to Disney World, on my honeymoon with my current ex-wife, in 2007, mm-hmm. around the time I was going to college for this stuff. And I made a short film, which is still available on my YouTube channel again. We've talked more about my YouTube channel than about my Blip channel.
Blip.
That's not right. We'll get to Some Jerk. But anyway.
Right.
But I shot a video, which is still on my YouTube channel, called My Trip to Walt Disney World. Which was basically just this experimental art fuck little film with random footage. It was Escape from Tomorrow before Escape from Tomorrow. Mm. Only it was more entertaining, I think. But
right.
it was basically just me at the place just shooting random stuff and interspersing random footage that had nothing to do with anything. And
uh-huh.
it was just my own personal little experimental art fuck Disney World thing. So that was the first inkling I had of just doing something funny with video at a Disney park. I've always been a huge fan of the Disney parks. Actually not always. There was a period in my teens when I talked about this in my Small World review where I just kind of had a fuck Disney corporation and all I want money.
You get jaded.
Exactly.
There's that
I had
time
jaded
of jading.
Teenage years.
I had that with regular television.
Exactly. I did too. Except for the Simpsons was the one show I never quite got jaded about until
right.
Yeah, until other shows came along that I was interested in. But anyway.
Exactly.
But as a kid, I was really into Disney trivia. I remember someone gave me a coffee table book called The Art of Walt Disney by, I want to say Christopher Finch wrote the, but someone mm-hmm. got that for me for Hanukkah, and I just read that thing cover to cover, and I became obsessed with the history of it. And then years later, I just kind of came back and rediscovered it and got interested again. And this time, got interested in the stories they weren't telling me and started reading, you know, insider blogs and listening to insider podcasts and... You know, just accumulating. It was just something I really got interested in because I love the idea. You know, I've always loved. I guess the reason I love Disney parks so much is, you know, movies are great and watching a movie is great. And you watch, you know, Raiders of the Lost Ark or something and it's fantastic, but it's just in that rectangle.
Right.
You know, you're looking at a glowing rectangle and the director is manipulating the lights on the screens and the images and only shooting this camera angle and blah, 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 blah. And, you know, it's good, but it's only that much of an experience. You go to the Indiana Jones ride at Disneyland and you're in the movie. It's surrounding you. Everything about the current experience. And obviously it's all fake, just like a movie is fake. But it's a new advanced kind of fakeness, which takes you by surprise in new and exciting ways. Now,
there's an extra immersion.
Exactly. Now, the caveat to that
mm-hmm.
is that Indiana Jones is by far the greatest thing the Disney parks have ever done, in my opinion. They have it's almost 20 years old at this point. They still have yet to top it. It's the pinnacle, in my opinion, of
this
Disney
is the Rover ride, right?
The Jeep.
The Jeep,
yeah,
right.
The Jeep, right. It's called, the full title is Indiana Jones and the Temple of the Forbidden Eye.
Right.
But the, it's in Adventureland at Disneyland. It's fantastic. Yeah, if you're, it's number one on the must-see list whenever you're in Disneyland. Although I believe at the moment it's closed for refurbishments. I'll have to, it was a couple mm-hmm. of weeks ago when I went to the park just to have fun. Hey, imagine that. But anyway.
Whoa.
So blah, 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 blah. But my point is, that's the peak of it. There's tons of alleys.
Right.
You know, there's tons of occasions where it doesn't live up to anywhere near the potential of its greatest stuff. And that's mm-hmm. what I'm interested in. That's what, you know, I'm interested in, you know, well, why can't we just have stuff as cool as Indiana Jones all over the park? You know, why can't we, you know, and the reason is, you know, there's that, just like any other thing, just like behind the scenes story of a movie, you know, there's, it's because these parks are run by mere people, you know,
right.
with their own agendas. And sometimes stupid things happen and budgets get slashed for the wrong reasons and the wrong stuff gets cut and you don't have a complete experience. And
or
things
some
get...
people get hired that shouldn't be hired.
Exactly. It's you know, stuff like that happens all the time, especially in the theme park industry. And I find that stuff fascinating. It's, you know, just like some people are, and I'm a film buff to on certain types of film. But you know, but theme parks, I'm just, especially Disney and Universal theme parks, I'm really, I've been really interested in for a number of years. And then when the Nostalgia Critic came along, it was just kind of a nice, now, it took me a couple years to actually get to this point.
Right.
But when I first saw The Nostalgia Critic, I remember it was like a year after I graduated from college. I'd made a couple of short films that I'd released on YouTube to no acclaim whatsoever. It was around the big original YouTube explosion when, you know, people
right.
like Smosh were getting, you know, I was... like, well, I'm at least as funny as those assholes. But that doesn't always translate. You know, they're
no right.
They're also really, you know. So I spent my entire senior year on a 30-minute sketch project of my own design called Radio Yeah, which is still on YouTube again, which didn't go anywhere. No one watched it. I think to this day it has about 100 views. And it just wasn't going to be my ticket anywhere else. So, but it was basically, literally and figuratively, my film school. It's like, okay, here's how I do this kind of stuff. Here's how I make it look maybe not entirely amateurish. Though there are some mm-hmm. very amateurish scenes in Radio Yeah. It's there's some really raw stuff in it and some really fun
right.
stuff. But it's uneven. But anyway, but when I saw what Doug Walker was doing, it was just kind of a revelatory moment of, I can do that. You know, hey, he's just sitting in front of a blank wall. He's, you know, I'm about as good a performer as that. I'm, you know,
I can write jokes.
Yeah, I can write jokes. I can react to things. And I liked how he was combining. It was like it was almost like MST3K 2.0 in a way. Like it was... It was the MST3K style of riff humor, but you didn't need to sit through the entire movie. You know, you could jump to various scenes. You could cut back to you. You know, you could have more host segments where it just cuts back to a random joke. You can play around with the format a lot. I saw the potential of the format of these kinds of reviews more than I was actually seeing it on the main site.
Right.
And, you know, and I was living in L.A. at the and eventually, now it took me a while to get to this point because I've always been very insecure about my, and also I decided after college for some reason that I didn't want to be a director or an editor or anything. I just mm-hmm. wanted to be a writer. But the problem is I'm not great at writing when I don't know the thing I'm writing is going to be produced. I kind of need that incentive. I need to know, like, okay, I'm going to, you know, go shoot this eventually. Otherwise, it just falls. Otherwise, I just lose the drive, you know,
right.
And that's just me. But and I know I'm never going to make it as just a writer with that attitude, and that's why I'm trying to be more than that. But anyway, so finally, in January of 2011, after literally years of just kind of hemming and hawing and, well, I need an editing program and I need a microphone and blah, blah, blah. Finally, I got off my ass, got all the things I needed together to make a decent show, and made a decent show. And shooting at Disneyland was just kind of my way of avoiding... It was my way of avoiding the blank wall. You know, I didn't want to just shoot in front of a blank wall. I wanted something that would differentiate me from, you know, all the other reviewers on Tiguatig. I wanted something that would, you know... And if you watch that first review I did of Country Bears, you know, I am absolutely aping Doug style. You know, I'm absolutely being just the whole structure of the episode is absolutely framed like a Nostalgia Critic episode.
Watch a video, react.
But here's the thing. No one has ever, you know, in this community where everyone accuses everyone of being a Nostalgia Critic ripoff, no one ever accused me. And I attribute that to the fact that, A, I shot in Disneyland, not in front of a white wall, and I wrote my own jokes. I didn't even mention This Is Not Over Bears, because I knew, you know, because Doug came up with the perfect joke to make in that scenario. Like, like he just realized there were bears in the movie.
Right.
Which is, you know, I acknowledge that's a gorgeous joke. I cannot think of anything better than that. I'm not going to try. I'm just going to skip over that. And I got commenters saying, you forgot about This Is Not Over Bears. And I didn't forget, you idiot. I'm just...
Yeah, it's just not my joke.
It's not my joke. Now, here's the thing, though. Had I been doing that today, I probably would have acknowledged that early on. Like, right when I cut to the Country Bears poster, cut to a shot of Christopher Walken saying, This Is Not Over Bears.
Over Bears.
Just to acknowledge to the audience that, yeah, I know it too. I'm not going to make the same joke, but I'm going to reference that. You know,
and
so,
to be honest,
so we're on
you probably brought one of the better quotes from that movie out.
Yeah, which is in the same video that it's in the same Doug video. He includes that, but he doesn't call attention to it.
Right.
So I love that line even. I love this isn't that day is tonight even more. I think it's genius. It's genius in its simplicity. It's like it's just a little twist that makes all the difference. And Walken sells it, man. He
sells that whole movie.
He doesn't have enough screen time to sell the whole movie. Unfortunately, he's in it for about a minute at a time in five different scenes. The scenes he's in, he steals. Yeah,
right.
That's the thing about the Country Bears is it's not as bad as it should have been, you know. But that's not saying much. Because based on the trailer, it should have been the worst movie ever fucking made.
Mm-hmm.
And in reality, Howard the Duck exists, so it's not. I know. I'm sorry. But the...
old wounds.
Howard the Duck and Jack Frost and, you know... I'm sorry. Okay,
it's
so
okay.
Anyway.
Right.
Where was I? I completely forget.
Starting to review at Disneyland and how that differentiated yourself from
Doug Walker. Well, I just, you know, it's like, hey, I go to... And also, I was looking for a way... When I first moved to Los Angeles in 2008,
mm-hmm.
my first major purchase was a Disneyland annual pass. I've always wanted to be able to go to Disneyland whenever I wanted. And suddenly I had that ability. And
you're super lucky.
But I abused it. Because here's the thing. I got the annual pass. I went like once a month.
Mm-hmm.
Every time I went, I had to do everything because I was Templeton the Rat at the fair, just kind of running around. I got tired of everything. I got tired of sitting through
too
the
much
same
of a good
ride.
Thing.
Exactly. I got tired of sitting through the same rides over and over again, and I just and. And I just, well, I don't want to not be a fan of this place anymore. I don't want to come here just once a year and have that be, I got to find an excuse to have this place continue to mean something to me. Some jerk with a camera.
Right.
If I keep coming back to film stuff here, you know, then
there's
I'm not just a nerd. I'm what Chris Hardwick calls a nerdist, you know. I'm taking something and I'm making it my own.
And you're finding new love for it.
I
really am.
And nowadays
and that shows.
Nowadays it's really rare that I'm going to the park where I'm not shooting anything.
Right.
You know, it's actually a couple weeks ago, me and Charlie and his wife Haley went there, and our friend Jared went there just to hang out for a day, just because we felt like doing it, and it was an interesting novelty.
And I mean, that's the other thing that I have to notice. Is that you are probably one of the only few reviewers that has physical cameos, that steady physical cameos from your LA crew or Team Jerk, as some people would say.
Indeed. Well, I don't care that much for the term Team Jerk. The way I see it, we're just the LA crew.
Right.
Because I think Team Jerk is a little too egotistical on my part. Yeah, this community that formed naturally,
well,
it's because
you know,
of me. It's these people who all like each other. Yeah, they're all no, I don't want to imply ownership of any
Well,
of
you
them.
Know, before All Critics Must Die, it was referred to as Jerkapalooza.
Yeah, but we'll that's based on a joke that's in the movie.
Oh, okay.
So
I apologize.
It's not your fault. The movie's not out yet. So
yeah.
But we'll figure that. But anyway, Skirdly Burr. Where was I?
Anyway, I'm talking about the physical cameos.
Right. The physical cameos. Well, that to me is just more interesting than remote cameos, because when you're shooting things remotely and you're not playing off someone who's right there, you know, it's not going to be impossible to pull off a good scene, but it is, the boulder you're pushing up the hill is twice as heavy, you know, and you know, people aren't going to respond quite as well. You know, it's not going to sound natural, in my opinion. Now, so whenever possible, I try to have the person physically there. In fact, I've made it a rule for my show. It hasn't really been applicable yet, but I've made a rule for my show that I'm not doing any remote co-reviews. I'm not going to do it. I'll do remote cameos now and then, but if I'm ever going to and this is just for my show. It doesn't have to be for anyone else's show. But yeah, I did a thing with Mike J, which was, it wasn't exactly a co-review, but it was an extended cameo, which lots of remote stuff. So I you know, everyone else is allowed to make whatever rules they want for their own shows, but for me, you know, if I'm going to do a full-on co-review with someone, they have to be in the park.
They
with
better
me.
Be.
Exactly. Now,
they
so
better
far,
be
I've only
my
done
vicinity.
One.
So far,
I've only done one, and frankly, it's one of my weakest episodes. So, but
which
I
one
do,
was that again?
That was the first Star Tours one.
Yeah, the
with,
first Star
with
Tours
Charlie
one,
Charlie
right.
and Morgan. But, or Spaz and the Wire, rather. But the, but I am planning another one, which will hopefully, drop either later this year or sometime next year.
Mm-hmm.
And that one I've been planning for a long, long time. See, I have all these ideas that have been just gestating for years that, you know, just haven't got around to yet. So we shall see.
And for developing something like this show, I know that for, at least for the It's a Small World, you had, I forget the timetable for it, but it was like three to 4 months that you have been working on the, you were working on that.
Well, it's a small. Well, kind of. I it fed off of the Halloween episode, which I did in October of 2011.
Right.
And I'd hoped to get. Now, here's the other thing. I didn't know it was going to be three parts. I knew it was going to be at least two parts. In fact, that's been the case with both 3-part episodes I've released so far. I planned them as 2-parters, but then the second part ran so long that I decided to cut it in half and make it 3 parts. And in both cases, I mean, but in the case of Small World, it's like I was able to get the first part uploaded before Christmas.
Right.
Which was very important to me to still justify, because it's a Small World holiday is what I was reviewing. The other two I wasn't able to finish until January, so
right.
I in both of those I put disclaimers at the top saying, you know what, just pretend it's next Christmas. I'm sorry,
right.
You know, it's
which it added
what
to
else
it
are you gonna
bit.
Do?
Mm-hmm. Because I know there's some folks, including myself, that have worked on reviews for like 6 months and stuff like that for reviewing. And you, by far, the more interesting one for production development with like what you were starting out with your editing software to what you're using now.
Yeah. When I started out, I was still using Windows Movie Maker.
And the stuff that you pulled off on it.
Well, here's the
mind-boggling.
I say that with a caveat. I was using a combination of Windows Movie Maker, Amersoft Video Converter, and Audacity.
Oh my god.
I was using Audacity to mix all the sound. I still do.
Right.
Although I don't need to mix the sound as much in Audacity. Mm-hmm. I just record in Audacity now cuz I can mix the sound in Premiere just fine. But
right.
Yeah, but when I was working on Movie Maker, man, I was pre-mixing all the audio before I even started. I had to pre-mix the audio first. And often, you know, and I was doing a lot of ADR, so I had to make sure the ADR right. matched. And then I had to get the video to match to that once that was done. And I used Amersoft whenever I needed, like, you know, to zoom in on an image. But I couldn't mm-hmm. zoom in. I couldn't do there was such a limited...
You couldn't do the, like, digital punch-ins and yeah, stuff
there was
like
such
that.
Yeah, there was such a limited amount of effects that Windows Movie Maker had. And when I switched to
but
Premiere...
But you used all of them.
I pretty much. I mean, it was...
A lot of patience.
In fact, you remember in the Captain EO review?
Yes.
The I Believe I Can Fly montage?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That montage broke my first computer.
No kidding.
That I was midway through editing that montage, and the computer just stopped working, and I had to restart it, and I got the blue screen of death.
Could you just say it had a cardiac arrest?
Oh!
No,
I couldn't,
because
it's not a human. It's a machine. It doesn't have a cardiovascular system.
I now feel deeply embarrassed. I'm gonna jump out of a window.
You should feel bad.
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So anyway, what were we?
Windows Movie Maker and Premiere.
Yeah, Windows Movie Maker. Yeah, when I switched over to it, I was naive enough to think Premiere would make me able to edit episodes faster. Ha! Mm-hmm. No. It just gives me more options, so I'm allowed to be more anal about it.
Right. And especially considering what you said, the advent of editing gives you so much more material to work with. I can tell.
Yeah.
Sometimes limitation is more of a godsend than a curse.
Now and then. I mean, there's certain presets that I was able to do in Windows Movie Maker, which don't exist in Premiere, like the spinning newspaper thing. Like mm-hmm. I did the spinning newspaper gag a couple of times when I was working on Windows Movie Maker. Now I would have to actually, you know, Photoshop the image onto the newspaper I wanted and actually write and then figure out the spinning. I would have to do it all manually now
with
so.
Keyframes and everything.
Exactly, but keyframes.
What was the first episode that you edited using Premiere?
30 Years of Epcot.
Okay, so that whole entire thing.
Yeah, that whole thing. And that, although I think I did a couple of, I think I did a Call It What You Like segment
mm-hmm.
before I started that in Premiere. But yeah, that was my first full episode. And it was a real learning curve. It took me a while to learn some of the things that would have made my life a whole lot easier had I known them.
Mm.
There you go.
Right. And, I mean, when developing the jokes for, Disneyland and the rides that you're reviewing, is it lucky that you've gone to the park so many times that
oh, absolutely.
You can now, like, call that sort of information off in your mind and write it down?
Without question, I mean, I know the parks, and that's always been the advantage I've had, is that I know the parks so well, it's like, well, okay, I'm doing a joke about a dinosaur here, so,
mm-hmm.
what dinosaurs are there in the, well, in the line for Big Thunder, there's the dinosaur bones, and there's, then by Toy Story Mania, there's Rex, and then there's the primeval world. That, you know, I narrow it down and I figure out, well, what's the easiest dinosaur visual reference, and, you know, and I can do that all mentally because I know the park so well, which is nice, you know. I mean, whenever I'm, you know, the first time I went to Florida for some dirk, it was 2011. It was 4 years after my previous trip there, and that episode is not that great, in my opinion, because I was kind of doing it on the fly more so than any of the others, and it was kind of rushed, and I, you know, because I only had while I was still in town to really write it, and it was you know, some of the rides I was talking about I hadn't even gotten a chance to ride before I went, so.
And was that during the time when Dave was there?
No, that was a different time. The time when Dave was there was when I recorded 30 Years of Epcot and all the Florida material for my ABC videos.
Right, so, okay.
Yeah, the long... I mean, you were talking about long lag times between when you think of an idea and when it's finally done. I've
30 Years of Epcot sounds like it's been about a full year.
Well, that is not by any means the longest lag time. The longest lag time between starting... I figured the math on this recently.
Mm-hmm.
The longest lag time between starting shooting an episode and having it online, 16 months.
Whew!
And that is a dead tie between Sabrina and the ABC Goes to Disneyland, the last episode of the ABC thing, which was about George Lopez and Modern Family. Because it's pretty much I think there's like 2 days difference between the amount of time it took. Because the very first shot I got in Florida on that 2012 trip was me at Universal in front of Hogwarts saying, you know, because seriously, fuck the Muggles' futures. That magical blonde needs to learn her gobbledygook. Only when she knows it all may she explain it all.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that was the first shot I ever got in Florida. And the episode was finally online, and that was in early September of 2012. The episode was finally online New Year's Day 2014. It was in a very close second, the ABC episode at the very end of that, where I'm having my big emotional crisis, and, you know, Nej and Spaz and Wire are trying to talk to me. That whole scene, the episode wasn't online until, I believe, February 28th, 2014. We shot it November 2nd, 2012. And I remember that being the exact day because it was the day Wreck-It Ralph came out.
Right.
And after we were done shooting, we all went to the AMC Downtown Disney and saw it. So it was... Oof. Yeah, it takes me a while to edit these things, but hopefully...
But when they...
But my hope is that I'll get them down to, the thing is, like, I could finish an episode beginning to end in a month if I really needed to.
Right.
I'm lucky enough at the moment to be in a position where I don't need to. You know, mm-hmm. No one is pressing on me for that, so I'm deliberately choosing to take the time to really make the episodes as good as they possibly can be, as memorable. I'm not worried about getting them in by a deadline for the most part. I'm worried about just, you know, how do I plus this? How do I make this better? How do I add a joke to it? You know, and I love that process. Now, if I had to stick to a deadline, I would. I would have no problem sticking to a deadline. It's just different ways of working. And,
it's a different workflow altogether.
And use what you got. You know, if you got the freedom to make it as good as you possibly can, do it. You know, because ultimately, once it's done, you got to live with it forever.
And that's the one thing I admire about Some Jerk with a Camera is, like, you're just doing it for the fun of it.
Yeah, for now.
We'll
see if it leads anywhere. I don't know.
Right.
But
I mean, you know. And
but I really, I avoid, like, things like site politics, like the plague. I mean, I don't, I really don't give a shit, like, you know, oh, you're not making, I'm not making as much money as you. You know, I don't care. And maybe that's just because I'm lucky enough to be in a position where I don't really have to care because I'm...
Right.
But you know, I'm...
basically, if it's not fun, what's the point?
Exactly.
Is my opinion, so...
And it, you know, it ultimately meddles with the end product, regardless of
exactly.
What regardless of what you initially set out to do.
Mm-hmm.
Now I'm gonna go off on a little bit of a tangent and say, like, how did you get connected with Spaz and Nej and Wire and, you know, the folks out in L.A.?
It happened pretty organically. We all had internet. Video shows, review shows, and we were all on the Tigwatig forums.
Mm-hmm.
And I forget who I think it might have been Morgan. I forget who it was exactly, but someone suggested, hey, everyone who's on these forums in the LA area, let's meet up. Let's, mm-hmm. you know, let's network. Let's figure out who each other is. And in fact, the very first time we all met, the very first time I met Spaz and The Wire is on video. It's one of the first video. I think it's the third video I ever uploaded to Blip, and that's Attack of the LA Reviewers Nice Day Apocalypse.
Oh, right.
Which was basically me, Spazmaster, The Wire, and Phil Bunny, who is kind of the Pete Best of the
right.
of the LA crew, all in Santa Monica, just basically goofing around, again, just riffing on shit, and
it was the nice weather, if I recall.
Yeah, exactly, and that's how we all first met, and we just spent the whole day together yakking it up, and by the end, I had three new friends, and then Mike Bennett, who plays Phil Bunny, eventually moved to Michigan, and then not exactly sure where he lives now. I know he eventually got on Shea Apocalypse and then was kicked off of Shea Apocalypse. And
that whole story, Phil, by that point, I was gone.
Yeah, Phil, I think, I don't want to say, you know, he's a nice guy. He's never been anything but nice to me.
Right.
But kind of...
He's intense,
and I think he's kind of a cautionary tale against getting too political in this kind of thing.
And getting too invested.
Yeah, and caring too much about making sure that people you think suck know that they suck.
Right.
You know, because everyone has an ego. I mean, mm-hmm. and people are, if you spend too much time saying, you know, well, here's where you're a failure, you know, I was lucky that, honestly, I mean, it's a double-edged sword in a way, because the very first feedback I ever got on Some Jerk with a Camera was from him, and it was uniformly positive. It was him saying, holy
right.
shit, this is amazing, can we be friends like now? And it was, and I, and I'm glad that my first feedback was from him and not from some troll, you know,
right.
who doesn't even like reviewers. I mean, it's, but at the same time, it's like... Why deliberately upset people? I mean, if what you're about to do has
because
no
that's the
other...
one thing about that that's the one thing about community that I don't understand is like why do some people just deliberately want to piss on
why
something
do
that's
you,
good?
Why do you want to be hated? I don't
right.
get that. I've never understood
it's
that mentality.
Masochistic. What? It's a very masochistic mentality.
Well, it's not masochistic. It's sadistic. It's sadistic.
You're right.
It's the you know, but the I just try to be nice to people, you know, because you never know who's going to become what, you know,
right.
you never know who's going to become the new head of Viacom or whatever, you know, it's
right,
like,
right, right.
And, you know, maybe if you're nice to someone when they're nobody, they'll remember you when you're somebody, you know, you never know. And if nothing comes to you being nice, you were still nice and you brightened a person's day.
Right,
you know,
and ultimately that's all that really matters
exactly.
in the long run. You know, you just got to be the polite dude.
Yeah,
yeah.
We'll be right back with polite talk here on
WKR2.
Yes, we're gonna discuss stealing a line from Patton Oswalt. Later, we're gonna learn how to make soup out of hugs.
We're gonna make soup out of womp,
womp, womp, womp, womp, womp. Next on Bill O'Reilly, why black people smell different. Wee, 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 wee.
Patton Oswalt is legit.
Did you see what he did on Twitter today?
No.
This is today as of where... Okay. He wrote a bunch of apologies for tweets he never wrote. Like, I apologize for the previous tweet. It's already deleted. Transgender people have a right to vote. I'm not, you know, I don't know what I was thinking. Oh, God, what am I thinking? Previous tweet deleted. The Holocaust victims should be respected.
It's just a
series of tweets going, you know, I apologize for the previous tweet. It's already deleted. And apologizing to the people who might be offended. And people actually got offended.
I don't
at tweets
understand.
He never even sent.
He was. He Does is, no one understand his shtick?
Brilliant. Here's what's brilliant about it. He's not trolling people. He's forcing the trolls to troll themselves.
Exactly.
He's forcing the people who thrive on offensivity to just, you know. To say, well, you made a rape joke? You can't make rape jokes. I didn't make a rape joke. You imagined a rape joke. You know, what does that say about
so,
you?
So, yeah, what does that say about
exactly.
your
it
thing?
Was
thought process?
Genius! Oh, I love Patton Oswalt. He's amazing. Anyway.
Yes. I mean, okay. I'm slowly winding down the questions. I mean...
Well, we've been talking for almost 2 hours now, so...
Right, I mean... And to tell you the truth, you hit every single question that I had written down on my fancy notepad.
Well, then I guess we're just done now, aren't we?
Well, screw you,
well,
Tony!
Just get all this with the... All right.
Well, I have... Two more questions. I have.
Oh, so you're not quite done, are you?
I'm not quite done.
Oh well,
I have two
you
more questions.
Contradict yourself.
Well,
you are at odds with you
happening.
Are you are deeply, profoundly at odds with yourself, sir. And I wish you good day.
Don't bring that.
Okay.
How odd would have that been if that's how the conversation between Woody and Buzz Lightyear?
You are a sad, strange little man, and Woody just shoots himself.
Right, it's like,
with the gun that he has.
Right, the non-gun that he has. He just hangs himself with his pull string.
Yep. That's a dark ending.
That's a dark ending
right
there.
I remember, you know, I remember talking to someone once about Toy Story 3, and they said, what if it just ended with them getting burned?
Get burned.
Wouldn't that be a crazy ending? Wouldn't that just they all get burned alive, and then just credits?
Well, what would have made it even darker if that plastic was then recycled to be used to make new versions of themselves?
Oh my God, that would
Would
they still
steps.
Have like flashback? Would it be like, you know? Would it be like that? That's the toy equivalent of reincarnation,
right?
You know, that's the
Would
they
have
these weird
of their
flashbacks of, you know, being at the daycare and being in the alien ball pit? What the? Why is it? Yeah, that would have. Why am I a dinosaur? I don't. Yeah.
Right. And the personalities have switched bodies
and
stuff like
that. But Woody wouldn't become a new Woody doll because they don't make him anymore.
No.
Because the show
got
canceled 50 years ago.
No, right. So he'd be some kind of, like, Buzz Lightyear, or, like, you know, it would have been really creepy.
Or he'd be a Combat Carl, or some other toy from that universe we haven't even heard of.
Right. Right.
Or, since kids don't even play with toys anymore, he'd just be recycled into a fucking iPhone.
A game cartridge.
Yeah, exactly.
Click, you got a friend in me.
Mm-hmm. What the... There's a snake in my boots. We're both saying it. Anyway, next question.
Okay, so the next question I would have to say, and this one you can... All Critics Must Die.
Yeah.
How was filming that? Because I know that it isn't out yet.
Right.
You guys had speculated that it was going to be released in February.
We speculated
2014?
A lot. We When it's out, basically, is the current party line. We don't know. We shot it way back in June of 2012. That's
right.
How long ago we shot the damn thing. And I can un- here's the thing. Shooting it was so intense. And it's like every moment, everyone was doing something. There was very and it was the most complicated project any of us had ever taken on.
Right.
And we, and by the end of it, we were all just kind of dead tired and exhausted, and we just didn't want to think about it anymore. We wanted a break from thinking about this fucking movie, and so we just kind of put it off to the side and never touched it again. You know, I mean, Jack and Josh have been working on it kind of off and on ever since. I don't want to get into it, but there was a bit of a falling out between them and someone else who was involved with the project, and that slowed things down a bit. And at the moment, I mean, they're allegedly working on it, but I'm not privy to what exactly they're doing. So, but once it does come out, a movie in a movie will still be the end credits theme.
Which is one of my favorite songs as well.
That one I'm very happy with. That was that one musically was very much Dokken.
All right,
Dokken. You remember Dream Warriors, the end credits theme to Nightmare on Elm Street 3?
Mm-hmm.
Movie in a movie is basically it's very much heavily inspired by Dream Warriors with a smidge of Bon Jovi's "You Give Love a Bad Name."
Yes.
And I just wanted that big 80s jock rock, you know, vibe. Just something people would raise their... And I'm, again, so happy with how it turned out. It was just... I just listen to it. Just it's on my band... We haven't even promoted my Bandcamp page. We've been talking about the album forever. Yeah.
I know.
Let me promote. My album, Goldmark After Dark, is available on my Bandcamp page... tony-goldmark.bandcamp.com. Do not forget the hyphen. It's
T-O-N-Y-hyphen
G-O-L-D.
There will be a link in the description link in the description as well as some other places. And the other thing would be you can get both the digital copy and a physical copy.
That's right.
You can get
a physical CD.
So if you want to get a piece of Tony Goldmark,
yeah,
ladies and gentlemen, it is $20. And I forget the exact price.
It's $10 plus
$10.
I believe $3 shipping and handling within the United States. And
exactly.
And you do get a piece of me. And don't worry about it. I regenerate. So.
Yeah. It's
painful
nice
at first, but you put ice on it and it's fine.
I mean, I have mine hanging on the wall right now.
Oh, good.
Yes, that's kind of what it was supposed to. That was the whole reason I got the physical copy.
Well,
there you go. Now, so we talked about movie within a movie. Kill Bosby.
What about him?
How did he come?
I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, guys, thank you for listening to...
Okay, Kill Bosby came about... a bunch of my friends were just having a Skype call one evening. And for some reason, I just started saying really fucked up shit in a Cosby voice. And everyone laughed their asses off.
Because the outtake specials for every Tony Goldmark season...
Yep.
Every Some Jerk with a Season are hosted by Mr.
Kill Bosby, yes, who is, I consider him Bill Cosby's Tyler Durden, basically.
Very much so.
He is or maybe Bill Cosby is Kill Bosby's Tyler Durden, but he's really the guy, he's calling all the shots. He's deciding what's gonna happen to the Cosby kids, and,
Right. Claire, what did I say about
damn it, Claire, why are you fucking around with time-traveling dinosaurs? Get your butt back in the kitchen and fix me some more delicious children with a knife.
I'm going to do it. I'm going to jump myself out this window.
I will jump. You all have blood on your hands. It's, you know, and it's, it's fun. It's, again, just an expression of the id. It's just whatever random shit I could possibly think of, just...
Because letting loose like that, it just... I've attempted such situations, And it is tiring, to say the least.
Well, so, try walking around and try borrowing my brain.
I can only imagine, but yeah, I mean...
So I went to the Supreme Court, and I said, listen, you castrated jackalopes, ain't nothing in the NFL rulebook says a kangaroo can't be time cop.
It's just, like, random stuff like that.
Exactly, and it's just fun. It's just fucking, you combine a bunch of shit together and say it in a Cosby voice, and it's funny. I mean...
And it just makes...
There's no real mystery to... I mean, look, Bill Cosby was quite possibly the most naturally funny human being to ever exist. But
exactly.
He never experimented. You know what I mean? He never went nuts. He was very funny, especially in the early days, but it was always very much the conventional kind of funny. Like, he never went dirty, he never went crazily, you know, he never went crazily absurdist.
Right, he didn't go blue.
He stayed within the kind of comfort level of, well, my wife is the smart one and my kids are dumb, and it's just that. I mean, have you seen his most recent special, Far From Finished?
No, I haven't yet.
You're not missing much, to be honest. The guy is so old, it takes him forever to get to a punchline. Like, there's literally one moment. There's a moment in the special where he reuses the old chestnut, you know, I brought you into this world, I'll take you out.
I'll take you out. Right.
And it takes him so long to say it, it's like, you know, and it's, I brought you into this world. And then someone in the audience starts saying, I'll take you out. And Cosby literally turns and says, no, let me say it. and the crowd went wild, but for the wrong reasons.
Right.
Because it doesn't seem like that was orchestrated on his part.
No.
It seemed like he was just allowing himself to be an aberrant child for that moment.
Right.
And
my special.
He was exactly, and it's just sad because he's one of the most naturally funny people, but he never went out of his comfort zone, and for that reason, to hear really really fucked up shit like tell you that once I was gang raped by the Rugrats, you know, it's suddenly the fuck. You know,
because and especially because you rehash his footage.
Yeah, and
just blue Bill Cosby just makes everything fantastic. Well, sir, it has been a whirlwind of an interview.
My trailer home got sucked way all the way over there. So
I know. Actually, you're right next to me right now.
I am indeed. Yeah.
It's kind of surprising.
We're in separate rooms. I can see you through the window. Should we just get in the same room?
I feel like we could.
All right. Let's do.
All right. Excuse me.
Hello.
Hey.
Wait.
How are you, man?
No, we're in. We switched. One of us should go into the other room where the other person. We just switched places. We're not in the same room. All right. Let's try this again.
Okay.
God damn it!
Dude!
What is this? You know what? Forget it. We'll just do this remotely.
Sure, fine. We'll do this, whatever.
I'm surprised.
You stay in that room.
You know, Sky, I was flying across the country in the giant tornado, and the Skype still worked. I don't know how, but it was.
You must have
never
been
failed.
Flying around a router or something during that whole entire thing. That, you know, it's lucky. You know, tornado reception is usually spotty.
Well,
but yeah.
Well,
okay. Thank you so much for this insightful and
my pleasure,
really
good sir.
One of the funnest interviews I've had so far.
This is a really well. You run a tight ship here, and you're a good. This isn't just like some guy deciding. I mean, it probably is, but it is. It doesn't feel like just some guy decided to do a podcast. You really. You're a damn good interviewer, I must say.
You're welcome. I try my best at being the person that I want to talk to everyone. So, and generally, this is what I do. I'm fascinated by people. So,
Keep on keeping on.
Yep, and same to you, sir. Same to you.
And so for those interested, again, my music is available at tony-goldmark.bandcamp.com. Some Jerk with a Camera, you can find at somejerkwithacamera.blip.tv. And I'm on Twitter. Follow me on Twitter at Tony Goldmark. And also,
you can also find him on The FUMP.
The FUMP, yes, on thefump.com. There are several songs of mine. Just go to the artist tab and scroll down until you get to Tony Goldmark.
It's not the great Lutzky. It's not the great Lutzky. It's Tony Goldmark.
Exactly. And also, you can cut this part out if not, but if you're uploading this thing by Wednesday, May 14th, there is a Kickstarter going on in which you can make me write a song for you. For a mere $400, this is part of the Logan Awards. The Logan Awards is an award show for comedy music. It's been given out every year for about 3 or 4 years now, and it's named after Logan Whitehurst, a very talented comedy musician who unfortunately passed away in 2006. But we named the They named the award show after him, and the trophy that they give to three different categories every year for best original song, best parody song, and best comedy video. The trophy is shaped like a robot cat because...
I believe you have one of those, sir.
I do not. I was nominated for one year,
oh,
but I did not win.
Okay.
Logan Whitehurst had a song called Robot Cat, so the Logan Award is shaped like a robot cat. And there's a Kickstarter going on to try to fund the creation of Logan Award statuettes for the next three Logan Award ceremonies.
Now, this year.
Well, for this year and for the next 2 years after that. The Kickstarter is funded for 2 years. They're trying to get it to three. And for a mere... And by contributing a mere $400 to this Kickstarter, you can make me or a selection of several other comedy musicians, you can make us write a song for you. And I'm one of the musicians you can choose from, and if you donate $400 to this Kickstarter, and if you do it before Wednesday, because Wednesday the 14th, because that's when this thing is over, you can make me write a song for you. Any song you want. No limits whatsoever. You can make me write a song about how much I suck, if you're so inclined. And you can find the link to that by going to loganawards.com and scrolling down until you get the news article about the Kickstarter and just...
It will also be included in the link down below as well.
Mm-hmm.
So.
All right.
All right, and you will... And just going to state this right now, you will also be performing at FumpFest,
yes. This is a convention that's going on in Chicagoland, Wheeling, Illinois, to be specific, at, I believe, the Westin North Shore. This is going on the weekend of June 22nd, I believe. Let me check the calendar with the... Yes, from June 20th to 22nd, and in Wheeling, Illinois, you can find... And I am performing a live set of comedy music there. You can find out all the details at FumpFest.com, FUMPFEST.com.
Right. Well, folks, this has been Pat Hazard and Tony Goldmark. Thank you all for listening, and please have a good night, be safe, and take care. This is Hazard signing out.
And until next time, I'm Some Jerk with a Camera.